Unsung, the story of Nate Dogg. The man who became Nate Dogg grew up in Clarksdale, Mississippi, as Nathaniel Hale Jr., the second of three children and the son of a Baptist minister.
My dad will hate me because he loves Mississippi, but they were slow. They were still sitting on the porch swatting mosquitoes in a very small town, one of everything.
We got our own eggs out the chicken coop. Ate them. My father shot pigs in the head, bop, hang them up, cut them, and we got our meat. That's how we live.
His dad was a pastor, and his mom was like in charge of the singing and stuff in the church.
I started a kids' choir at the church, so that's what we've done. Our family is just singing. That's what we do.
My mom made a little group. It was a little trio, Pam, Buddy, and Sam. Buddy, also known as Nate.
Can you imagine being in a home with a pastor? There was no music being listened to, unless it was gospel music.
But when Nate was 14, his parents divorced, and he moved to Long Beach, and a very different musical scene.
I went to Poly High School in 1986, and we had a class together, you know, freestyling and rapping and singing, and we're supposed to be learning, but at the same time, we was learning each other and learning, you know, how to have style.
Snoop was doing his rap thing, and Nate was walking around singing and stuff, so they would have little battles at lunchtime, you know, and it just got popular.
At age 17, Nate left high school to join the Marines. He served 3 years as a munitions specialist, but was discharged under murky circumstances.
He came home unauthorized a couple of times, and my grandfather had to drive him back to Camp Pendleton. But he eventually got out because he said he didn't want to be there anymore. He didn't like it. He didn't like being told what to do.
He did say it taught him a lot. He told us that they teach you to not have no fear of nothing.
Returning to the hard streets of Long Beach in the late 80s, Nate Dogg reunited with Snoop Dogg and with their homie, Warren G.
At that time, me and Snoop was all over the place, going to clubs and stuff like that. And then when we connected with Nate, we was like, well, we want you to be with us. You know, you could be the person to do the singing in the group.
Snoop, Warren, and Nate formed a group called 213 after the local area code and worked on demos in the back of a store called VIP Records.
I mean, this is where it all started, without a doubt and stuff. And, you know, the fact that, you know, I was able to do something in the neighborhood to pull these cats up off the street and stuff and give them a safe place to practice on their skills. I was really excited about the demo tape that we did.
You know, you got to get your music to the right person. Get it to the right person. If they like it, it's on after that. It just happened to be Warren knew Dre.
Dre was Dr. Dre of NWA, Warren G's stepbrother, and already a top-of-the-line producer at Death Row Records.
Warren G used to keep the tape on him. He ended up going to a bachelor party that Dr. Dre had threw for one of his friends. And Warren G, you know, took it amongst himself to slide our cassette in.
I was like, this is me, Nate, and Snoop. You know, my group I've been telling you about.
Well, he ended up having me and Nate Dogg and Warren G come to the studio. He seen something in us to where it was like, I could really work y'all. Like, I could really bring out the best in y'all.
But for all that, only Snoop was signed as an artist to Death Row, effectively ending 213 as a group.
We were 213 when we were presented to Dr. Dre. It wasn't Snoop Doggy Dogg, it was 213. It made me feel real bad that I got a contract and I'm signing, my homeboys don't.
Dre did include Nate on a track on his classic LP, The Chronic. But Nate's real breakthrough came in 1994 when he co-starred with Warren G on Warren's first single, Regulate, about a robbery gone wrong.
It was a clear black night, a clear white moon. Warren G was on the streets trying to consume some skirts for the E,
so I could get some phones, rolling in my ride, chilling all alone.
Just hit the east side of the LBC on a mission trying to find Mr. Warren G. Seen a car full of girls, ain't no need to tweak. All of you search, know what's up with 213.
So I told Nate, let's try to do something different. So I said, well, I started off with the first four bars, and then I want you to come in with four bars after me.
Since these girls peeping me, I'm gonna glide and swerve. These looking so hard, they straight hit the curve. Want to bigger, better things than some horny tricks. I see my homie and some suckers all in his mix.
It was a story. It was like the singing version of Run DMC with him and Warren G. And it was catchy as hell.
They got my homie hemmed up and they all around. Can't none of them see him if they going straight down for pound. They wanna come up real quick before they start to clown. I best pull out my and lay them busters down.
That hadn't really been heard before, where you had a rapper and a vocalist compliment each other, really making a song that really felt like they wrote it together.
I'm going down. I can't.
Featured in the film Above the Rim, Regulate shot into the top 10 singles charts for pop, R&B, and hip hop.
It was, you know, unique at the time. And that was the introduction for Nate to the world.
To have a smooth crooner singing some hardcore street stuff, that was kind of funny at first, but then he put it down.
It wasn't that him singing, you know, gangster was new. It's a lot of guys that sung gangster, you know, but it's the way he did it and however he feeling at that point, he gonna talk about it and he gonna sing it in a way to where you listen like, damn.
But for all his impact on G-Funk, friends say that Nate Dogg was never really a G.
In Long Beach, I was a part of a gang, but Nate wasn't a part of a gang. Nate chose to sing and do his thing with us.
Nate was more like a hustler with it. You know, if it was like a little dirt had to be done in situations, mainly about money. But far as running out there, shooting another brother and acting silly, ain't none of that going on.
Not that Nate was immune from trouble. By 1994, he'd been arrested several times, including criminal charges for robbing a check cashing company and a Taco Bell.
Long Beach, California is just street life, period, all day, every day. And so we all got caught up in, you know, that way of life.
Okay, tough guys, bend over. Now, call.
Nate beat the raps, then used them as inspiration for his first solo single, a song he titled One More Day.
Now I was about 8 when I got my first case. My mother, she turned her back and bowed her head in disgrace.
It's kind of like describing, you know, life of a Long Beach guy trying to make it out. And then he was kind of describing himself.
Usually, I'm in the house, but today I snuck off. And when I walk down the Long Beach streets, what a lesson they taught.
And he was like, thank you, Lord, for one more day, because tomorrow ain't promised. I can go to jail.
That's like a penitentiary thing. Some of my people that I know, that was one of their favorite songs by Nate. And you can hear the church in that too.
His thing was to sing and to connect that way, but he still was gangster. So his whole mentality and his whole delivery was based off that.
That mentality came in handy at Death Row Records, where Nate often recorded with other artists, notably Tupac Shakur, and where he'd been signed to a song publishing deal by Suge Knight, for better or worse.
He never went there without his pistol. He said, when I go there, I handle my business, and that's it.
I seen Nate putting on a bulletproof vest, and I'm like, hold on, player, what are we going to the studio or? Finna go to Iraq, what's up? What kind of studio is this where we gotta put bulletproof vests on and walk in? I mean, how can we even work around this type of environment?
I mean, at a certain point, we all felt uncomfortable. And that's just the truth of it all. We come from the streets and we come from the hood. It's better to be caught with than without.
Nate had his guns with him every time. He just used to say, man, I feel fear of my life every time I walk into this building. And Suge would just say, oh, they ain't gonna touch you. Don't worry about it. But it was almost like to keep the foot on the neck.
Despite all that, through the mid-90s, Nate recorded tracks at Death Row for his first solo album there. Or so it seemed.
As the years went on without the release of his stuff, then he started getting, you know, angry and bothered and hurt.
We had finished the record, everything was ready to roll, and Suge acted like he was gonna put the record out, but he still had him on, you know, on the shelf. And then that's like when the relationship started to fall apart.
Finally, in 1998, 6 years after he began recording, Nate released his debut album on Breakaway Records, fueled by a surprisingly emotional ballad he sang with Snoop Dogg called Never Leave Me Alone.
Nate Dogg was able to tap into an emotion that, you know, we as gangsters at the time, we wasn't able to. But it was the emotion of Nate Dogg being able to open his heart up and show me how to open my heart up, which is Never Leave Me Alone. We had never really had a record where we expressed our vulnerability as far as not wanting to be alone.
My brother did not like to be alone. That's why I used to always say I couldn't be in a cage. I couldn't be in jail.
I traveled so many places, I've seen so many faces. That line right there just had me feeling good. It kind of, that song was like sad, but banging at the same time.
Never Leave Me Alone became Nate Dogg's first charting single as a solo artist, climbing to number 22 for R&B.
That was his truth, Never Leave Me Alone. But he meant it in more than one way, and that was creatively. Never Leave Me Alone. Allow me to tap into my creative intelligence and express myself.
Nate Dogg's long-awaited debut album made it to number 20 on the R&B charts. But compared to the multi-platinum success of friends like Snoop Dogg, Warren, and Dr. Dre, its success was modest.
I think the first week it sold like 33,000 or something. And that's really not good numbers. So that had him pissed off.
I used to tell him, something's missing with you when you do it by yourself. It's like his music by itself had to grow on you.
My brother was raised singing with me, my sister. With himself, he's nice, he's tight. But as far as working with others, singing with somebody else is better for him.
So Nate put his mouth where the money was, providing hooks for other rappers, including Mos Def and Pharoah Monch.
Mos was like, thinking about Nate Dogg on the chorus. And I was like, really? Like, you know, we these like East Coast underground MCs, and Nate lays this chorus, and I'm like, we got one. Look at who they let in the back door. From Long Beach to Brooklyn, they know. We rock from the East to West Coast. Queens of Loopy, they know.
That's just an amazing record. That hook, who knows what he's talking about in the hook? It just sounds great. Sky's the limit, game's infinite when I'm in it.
All windows are tinted, seeing me when I'm in it. Oh No shot to number one on the charts. That's my Nate Dogg. Oh no, niggas ain't scared to hustle. It's been 7 days, the same clothes. Ask them originals, cause they know. All step, Nate Dogg, fair roll.
When Nate got on your songs, it did more than validate it. It made it a hit.
A few months later came a song with Fabulous called Can't Deny It. I can't deny it. I'm a rider. You don't wanna fuck with me. Yeah. Got scales in the trunk
with me. Okay. Switching lanes to a buck with me. That's right. That was just pure catchy Nate Dogg, man. It just his pocket and his flow on it was just
It's unmatchable, man. He was unmatchable with that.
I can't deny it. I'm a mixed rider. You don't wanna fuck with me. I can't deny it. I'm getting cloudy. And you wanna fuck with me.
I got scales in the trunk with me.
Okay.
Switching lanes to a buck with me.
That's right.
I can't deny it.
Can't Deny It became Fabulous's first hit single. And a crossover smash.
Nigga, I ride till I die. I'm hollering 187 when I ride through the side. Fool.
Y'all can't deny it. I'm a mixed rider. You don't wanna fuck with me.
Yeah.
Fabulous was a new artist, so I think he need to give Nate all the praise, because Nate kicked down the door for him. Put him in the game.
But Nate's knack for combining gospel hooks with gangsta looks also put his music at odds with the person he cared for the most.
My mother is a Christian. She goes to church. She do not listen to that music. She don't care if it's her son, sister, brother. She's not gonna play it.
Why you gotta be singing about, you know, weed? And you know mama ain't gonna like that, and mama can't listen to that, and we didn't grow up like that.
I understand the testimonial singing as far as what they did in their life, but the language is not what I would agree with.
He battled the two, knowing what he was raised to become as far as, you know, living by the word of God and doing what's right and wrong and doing, you know, he knew better, but he figured, you know, this is what his talent was. This was his calling, and he didn't want to miss his calling.
And as Nate spun out his hit-making hooks, the money got better too.
He did want, you know, success as a solo artist, but he wasn't stupid. You know, he knew that, you know, that was a lane for him that could be lucrative, and he taxed people for it. Don't trip, he taxed.
He was very hot, and everybody, you know, wanted him on their record. I think at that time, Nate was getting about 150 a hook. 150,000.
He was happy in the sense that he was recognized for his talent. He realized that it made a lot of other things for him possible.
I think the main thing he liked about it was the money. And then next, I would say the women.
Everybody loves the ladies, you know. Sometimes he loved them a little bit too much.
Nate Dogg would ultimately father 9 children by several women.
When he was home, we spent a lot every day together, a lot of time together. But a lot of his kids lived out of state, and he managed to work it out, I guess, you know, around his schedule. When he go to their cities, I think he'd go see them.
A number of them were not planned, and some were. But he understood clearly the responsibility. I saw to that, you know, you just can't make them and leave them. You gotta make them and take care of them, and you've got an obligation to fulfill.
I got holes in different area codes. Area codes. Holes.
Not by coincidence, many of Nate's memorable hooks boasted of his prowess with the ladies, notably on a 2001 single with Ludacris called Area Codes.
I got holes in different area codes.
Area code. He did not lie about that. Whatever city he go in, whatever state, he go at somebody he can call.
Now every day is a holy day. So stop the violence and put the 4-4 away. Skeet shoot a holy day. 504-972-713. What you gonna do?
I think area codes is so universal with me. I'm mad I didn't make that record, because at that time I thought I had holes in different area codes.
Whatever it is, they love it and they just won't let me be.
Through the late 90s and early 2000s, Nate Dogg was rap music's undisputed hook king, appearing on dozens of singles by artists from Dr. Dre to 50 Cent to Eminem.
I don't think he ever thought his songs were never as big as the ones he did for other people, because the songs he did for other people, he thought were his songs.
He did all of his own harmonies, he did all of his, you know, his own writing. He was self-contained. He didn't have a ghostwriter. Those thoughts came directly from him.
It's like bringing the drive-by to a recording studio. And I say that in a safe sense, because as soon as you get there, it's that music going, that good green, that good Henny, that good atmosphere and food, and he's right straight to it. And when he finished, it's like, okay, what else? Pull something else up.
But Nate's penchant for drinks and drugs went well beyond the recording studio.
He'd get three bottles of Hennessy. One bottle was to sit in a limo for everybody else. Other bottle, he's put behind the seat when he leaves the club. The other bottle, he opened right there and started drinking at the house.
He'd have his own bottle. You know, like, this my bottle, y'all get your own bottle.
And there'd be days he wouldn't drink at all. But then there'd be days where he'd get in the studio and start recording, and he'd just want to have his drink. And that was his thing, man.
He was able to live good, like, better than most, but the drinking weed and the partying all the time and getting out there like that, I think it took him down the wrong road, the wrong path.
Told you she's a whore. Yeah.
In 2003, Nate reunited with Snoop Dogg and Warren G for their only studio album together and a single titled Groupie Love. Greater than an X-rater with a nickname like Vibrator. I need to do the remix to
Area Code. In plenty mode. I'm thankful that we did do it. I'm thankful for Warren G for always pushing that on us to do it. And once we started to do it, it was like, wow, what took us so long?
It wasn't just three guys getting together, but it was Snoop Dogg, Nate Dogg, and Warren G. And he really felt that that was another step for him in terms of his growth.
Nate's love for the ladies always been there. You know, that's one thing about him. He definitely a ladies' man.
Reuniting 213 with Snoop Dogg and Warren G brought Nate Dogg's music career full circle while suggesting even brighter days ahead.
He had control over whatever he wanted to do, the artists he wanted to work with. So he seemed more free and more happier.
I'm at a point in my life where I want to challenge my voice to where, like, I don't want to just go in the studio and do something. Hey, that's Nate Dogg, that's his boy. I want to go in there with somebody that really sits down and does great music and challenge that.
Nate seemed to be enjoying life offstage as well, privately taking family time with his children who live nearby.
The fatherly side of him was another side of him that a lot of people didn't get to see, and he would always be around his kids whenever you'd go to his house or whenever he'd come to my house, he'd always have his kids with him.
Being his son, I always seemed like the quiet, nice side, but then I had to be in the bed by 12, and that was when, you know, that was when everything basically started for him. So, you know, he would get his Hennessy and whatever, him and his boys, and they, you know, if something pop off, I could just hear it.
Nate recognized that he had two sides to himself. And the way he described to me is that, Rod, I got an angel on this shoulder and a devil on this shoulder. And depending on where I am, what mood I'm in, or what's going on, the bigger voice gets the attention.
When he drank, he would start tripping out. They would call him, his trip out name was Buddy Love. And he'd be like, you don't want to see me when I turn into Buddy Love, trust me.
Nate Dogg was cool, but when Buddy Love came out, it was a whole different beast. Lord have mercy.
He flipped that switch, he no joke. You know, however you want, he gonna give it to you.
Nate had a temper, okay? You don't want to get Nate hot.
In the year 2000, Nate had been arrested for kidnapping and assaulting a former girlfriend. Those charges were dismissed. Then in 2006, an encounter with another ex-girlfriend led to charges of trespassing, dissuading a witness, battery assault, and violating a restraining order.
Nate was engaged to this girl, and Nate had gave her like a 4-carat ring, and Nate wanted the ring back. And she was with a boyfriend, and Nate ran up in the house trying to get the ring back,
and the boy said something to him, and Nate knocked him out.
I was like, man, you can't just run up in nobody's house and put hands on nobody, man. They can sue you, man, and you can go to jail. He was drunk, you know. But the girl ended up letting it go.
I would basically remind him about his lifestyle for indulging in alcohol and even his eating habits, which were really bad. And I talked to him about the dangers of different type of women and things like that. You know, so he just chose to do that.
Then, in 2007, while driving with a girlfriend, Nate was seriously injured in a car wreck.
That was the beginning of the end, when that car flipped and he got staples in his head because he kept drinking.
He checked himself out of the hospital. He had a performance in Vegas. He left to go do that, still with the internal bleeding, still sick. Should have been in the hospital. And then from there, it just pretty much went downhill.
A few months after that, Nate suffered a massive stroke.
He just lost the use of his left side, which was a big deal because he was left-handed. So he had to rely on a little bit more people, a little more to do things for him.
You know, he had to have his double shot of Hennessy and his weed. And I honestly believe that that eventually went to his mind, and all of a sudden, stroke.
Me and my wife went to go visit him, and my wife had said something to him. She was like, I thought you said you broke up with her. And he was like, nah, I can't break up with her yet. I still love her. And I didn't know what the hell they was talking about. Then I looked down, and there was a bottle of Hennessy right by his leg. And I'm like, okay.
Nate gradually got back on his feet, then surprised everyone by forming a gospel choir called In Nate Praise.
When he was like, yeah, man, I want to start a choir. And I was just like, really? He's like, yeah, I want to start a choir. He was like, go on Craigslist and post auditions for this coming weekend. I said, okay. So the next morning I got up, I got on Craigslist, I post auditions for a hip hop crooner starting a choir, and we started getting the phone calls.
I auditioned and I got in the group. Then it turned into him kind of really mentoring me and supporting me and uplifting me.
In Nate Praise, then he was giving something for my mother and father to listen to. They would listen to that. That's what was bringing him back over here on the side of where we was raised at.
He had me and some of the my family members come over and to the studio where he had them and help them out with some songs that he wanted to sing.
He loved his mother like you wouldn't believe and felt that he needed to make a commitment in the art form that she could listen to, that she could appreciate. And that was his way of saying, Mom, I'm your boy, and that part of me still exists, and I want to express it in my art.
Nate Dogg was living a kind of triple life, struggling to recover from a stroke, leading a gospel choir, and still living the high life of a rap star.
We just kind of like scolded him, like, do right, do right, do this, do that. You got high blood pressure, take your medicine. We would be on him all the time.
A lot of people told him, Nate, maybe you shouldn't be drinking, you know, and he said, no, I'm gonna do this. Let me do me, you know, don't worry about me.
I knew what he was doing, and I always prayed for him because I know he was in a position that he needed God to protect him.
In another startling move, Nate Dogg abruptly married his then-girlfriend, LaToya Calvin, in the summer of 2008. But a few weeks later, she filed for divorce.
He had high blood pressure, and that had to be maintained, and he was taking medication for that. But I think the stress factor and the intensity of both the lifestyle and just all the things he was dealing with, it eventually, you know, took its toll.
A few months after that, Nate Dogg suffered a second massive stroke, one which would physically incapacitate him for the rest of his life.
He was paralyzed from the neck down. Couldn't walk or talk. Couldn't do anything. And that was hard to take for 2.5 years.
He had to literally give up everything that he did, He couldn't take care of himself.
He had to get a tracheotomy, so that impacted his ability to speak. I give credit to his mother and working with her sister to initiate a method where we could communicate beyond just the eye movement.
He would look at a group of letters and I would say, is it J? And he would just look straight. Is it K? He would look straight. But when I say, is it L? We communicated by him looking up. So when he said L, he'll look up and then I write L. And then he could look at different groups until he would spell what he was trying to say.
Mentally, he was all there. So, you know, the witnessing of his demise, so to speak, physically was very painful to watch, and it was over a long period of time, so it was very hard.
Put his little hat on, they put him in the wheelchair, I push him outside, and I'm just talking to him like, you know, I love you, cuz I got your back. You know, just giving him, making my dude feel like he's supposed to feel in the moment.
I went and seen him and sat down with him. I would just talk about a bunch of stuff, just so hard to where I started crying. You know, and I would tell him, man, I'll be back, man. Just, you'll be all right. We're gonna get you through this, man. Just, you know, I gotta bounce, but I'll be back, man. I'll be back.
I knew that he was not gonna recover. I knew that that would be the last time I saw him alive. And I knew that I had to tell him everything that I ever wanted to tell him, and I did.
Nathaniel Hale Jr., Nate Dogg, died in 2011 from complications of multiple strokes. He was 41 years old.
You think you're prepared, but you're not.
I lost my best friend.
Excuse me. I probably played his music for like a whole week. You know, excuse me. It was hard for me, you know, real hard. I had to walk out to the back because I couldn't, you know, go down there and look at my homeboy in a casket.
That was like the worst day of my life because he was my friend, like really my friend. We had a kid together, like, I loved him so much, I wanted to see him happy no matter what he did in his life.
Nate Dogg is like our Marvin Gaye. He was our hip-hop crooner.
He made it okay for that dude from the hood to find a song that he could sing to, that he could be emotional.
You'll never have another Nate. It's just he had his own style and charisma to what he did. Tell me that you want me.
Nate made everybody that he worked with better. And when you can make everybody you work with better, then you've done your job.
Climbing to number 22 for R&B.
That was his truth, never leave me alone. But he meant it in more than one way, and that was creatively, never leave me alone. Allow me to tap into my creative intelligence and express myself.
Nate Dogg's long-awaited debut album made it to number 20 on the R&B charts. But compared to the multi-platinum success of friends like Snoop Dogg, Warren, and Dr. Dre, its success was modest.
I think the first week it sold like 33,000 or something. And that's really not good numbers. So that had him pissed off.
I used to tell him, something's missing with you when you do it by yourself. It's like his music by itself had to grow on you.
My brother was raised singing with me, my sister. With himself, he's nice, he's tight. But as far as working with others, singing with somebody else is better for him.
So Nate put his mouth where the money was, providing hooks for other rappers, including Mos Def and Pharoah Monch. Oh, no.
Niggas ain't scared to hustle. It's been 7 days, the same clothes. Ask them originals, cause they know. All step, Nate Dogg, very roll.
Most was like, thinking about Nate Dogg on the chorus. And I was like, really? Like, you know, we these like East Coast underground MCs, and Nate lays this chorus, and I'm like, we got one.
Look at who they let in the back door. From Long Beach to Brooklyn, they know. We rock from the East to West Coast. Queens to Luke, they know.
That's just an amazing record. That hook. Who knows what he's talking about in the hook? It just sounds great.
Sky's the limit, game's infinite when I'm in it. All windows are tinted, seeing me when I'm in it.
Oh No shot to number one on the charts.
That's my Nate Dogg.
Oh No, niggas ain't scared to hustle. It's been 7 days, the same clothes. Ask them originals, cause they know. All step, Nate Dogg, very roll.
When Nate got all your songs, it did more than validate it. It made it a hit.
A few months later came a song with Fabulous called Can't Deny It.
I can't deny it. I'm a mixed rider. You don't wanna fuck with me.
Yeah.
Got scales in the trunk with me.
Okay.
Switching lanes to a buck with me.
That's right.
That was just pure catchy Nate Dogg, man. It just his pocket and his flow on it was just. It's unmatchable, man. He was unmatchable with that.
I can't deny it. I'm a mixed rider. With me.
I can't deny it, and Clyde, and you wanna walk with me.
Got scales in the trunk with me.
Okay.
Switching lanes to a buck with me.
That's right.
I can't deny it.
Can't Deny It became Fabulous's first hit single and a crossover smash.
I ride till I die. I'm hollering 187 when I ride through the side.
I can't deny it. I'm a rider. You don't wanna walk with me.
Yeah.
Fabulous was a new artist, so I think he need to give Nate all the praise, because Nate kicked down the door for him, put him in the game.
But Nate's knack for combining gospel hooks with gangsta looks also put his music at odds with the person he cared for the most.
My mother is a Christian. She goes to church. She do not listen to that music. She don't care if it's her son, sister, brother. She's not gonna play it.
Why you gotta be singing about, you know, weed and, you know, mama ain't gonna like that, and mama can't listen to that, and we didn't grow up like that.
I understand the testimonial singing as far as what they did in their life, but the language is not what I would agree with.
He battled the two, knowing what he was raised to become as far as, you know, living by the word of God and doing what's right and wrong and doing, you know, he knew better, but he figured, you know, this is what his talent was. This was his calling, and he didn't want to miss his calling.
And as Nate spun out his hit-making hooks, the money got better too.
He did want, you know, success as a solo artist, but he wasn't stupid. You know, he knew that, you know, that was a lane for him that could be lucrative, and he taxed people for it. Don't trip, he taxed.
He was very hot, and everybody, you know, wanted him on their record. I think at that time, Nate was getting about 150 a hook, 150,000.
He was happy in the sense that he was recognized for his talent. He realized that it made a lot of other things for him possible.
I think the main thing he liked about it was the money. And then next, I would say the women.
Everybody loves the ladies, you know. Sometimes he loved them a little bit too much.
Nate Dogg would ultimately father 9 children by several women.
When he was home, we spent a lot every day together, a lot of time together. But a lot of his kids lived out of state, and he managed to work it out, I guess, you know, around his schedule. When he go to their cities, I think he'd go see them.
A number of them were not planned, and some were. But he understood clearly the responsibility. I saw to that. That, you know, you just can't make them and leave them. You gotta make them and take care of them, and you've got an obligation to fulfill.
I got holes. I got holes. In different area codes.
Area
codes. Holes.
Not by coincidence, many of Nate's memorable hooks boasted of his prowess with the ladies, notably on a 2001 single with Ludacris called Area Codes.
I've got holes
in different area codes.
Area codes.
Holes.
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 In different area codes.
Area.
Yeah, had one in every area code. He did not lie about that. Whatever city he go in, whatever state, he go at somebody he can call.
Now every day is a holy day. So stop the violence and put the 44 away. Skeet shoot a holy day. 504-972-713. What you gonna do?
I think area codes are so universal. I mean, I'm mad I didn't make that record, because at that time I thought I had holes in different area codes.
Whatever it is, they love it and they just won't let me be.
Through the late 90s and early 2000s, Nate Dogg was rap music's undisputed hook king, appearing on dozens of singles by artists from Dr. Dre to 50 Cent to Eminem.
I don't think he ever thought his songs were never as big as the ones he did for other people, because the songs he did for other people, he thought were his songs.
He did all of his own harmonies. He did all of his, you know, his own writing. He was self-contained. He didn't have a ghostwriter. Those thoughts came directly from him.
It's like bringing the drive-by to a recording studio. And I say that in a safe sense, because as soon as you get there, it's that music going, that good green, that good Henny, that good atmosphere and food, and he's right straight to it. And when he finished, it's like, okay, what else? Pull something else up.
But Nate's penchant for drinks and drugs went well beyond the recording studio.
He'd get three bottles of Hennessy. One bottle was to sit in a limo for everybody else. Other bottle, he's put behind the seat when he leaves the club. The other bottle, he opened right there and started drinking at the house.
He'd have his own bottle. You know, like, this is my bottle, y'all get your own bottle.
And there'd be days he wouldn't drink at all. But then there'd be days where we'd get in the studio and start recording, and he'd just want to have his drink. And that was his thing, man.
He was able to live good, like better than most, but the drinking weed and the partying all the time and getting out there like that, I think it took him down the wrong road, the wrong path.
Told you she's a whore.
In 2003, Nate reunited with Snoop Dogg and Warren G for their only studio album together and a single titled Groupie Love.
I'm thankful that we did do it. I'm thankful for Warren G for always pushing that on us to do it. And once we started to do it, it was like, wow, what took us so long?
It wasn't just three guys getting together, but it was Snoop Dogg, Nate Dogg, and Warren G. And he really felt that that was another step for him in terms of his growth.
Just about to call till Snoop Dogg told me that he phoned you.
Nate's love for the ladies always been there. You know, that's one thing about him. He definitely a ladies' man.
Reuniting 213 with Snoop Dogg and Warren G brought Nate Dogg's music career full circle, while suggesting even brighter days ahead.
He had control over whatever he wanted to do, the artists he wanted to work with, so he seemed more free and more happier.
I'm at a point in my life where I want to challenge my voice to where, like, I don't want to just go in the studio and do something. Hey, that's Nate Dogg, that's his boy. I want to go in there with somebody that really sits down and does great music and challenge that.
Nate seemed to be enjoying life offstage as well, privately taking family time with his children who live nearby.
The fatherly side of him was another side of him that a lot of people didn't get to see. And he would always be around his kids whenever you'd go to his house or whenever he'd come to my house, he'd always have his kids with him.
Being his son, I always seemed like the quiet, nice side. But then I had to be in the bed by 12. And that was when, you know, that was when everything basically started for him. So, you know, he would get his Hennessy and whatever, him and his boys. And they, you know, if something pop off, I could just hear it.
Nate recognized that he had two sides to himself. And the way he described it to me is that, Rod, I got an angel on this shoulder and a devil on this shoulder. And depending on where I am, what mood I'm in, or what's going on, the bigger voice gets the attention.
When he drank, he would start tripping out. They would call him, his trip out name was Buddy Love. And he'd be like, you don't want to see me when I turn into Buddy Love, trust me.
Nate Dogg was cool, but when Buddy Love came out, it was a whole different beast. Lord have mercy.
He flipped that switch, he no joke. You know, however you want, he gonna give it to you.
Nate had a temper, okay? You don't want to get Nate hot.
In the year 2000, Nate had been arrested for kidnapping and assaulting a former girlfriend. Those charges were dismissed. Then in 2006, an encounter with another ex-girlfriend led to charges of trespassing, dissuading a witness, battery assault, and violating a restraining order.
Nate was engaged to this girl, and Nate had gave her like a 4-carat ring, and Nate wanted the ring back. And she was with a boyfriend, and Nate ran up in the house trying to get the ring back, and the boy said something to him, and Nate knocked him out.
I was like, man, you can't just run up in nobody's house and put hands on nobody, man. They can sue you, man, and you can go to jail. He was drunk, you know. But the girl ended up letting it go.
I would basically remind him about his lifestyle for indulging in alcohol and even his eating habits, which were really bad. And I talked to him about the dangers of different type of women and things like that. You know, so he just chose to do that.
Then, in 2007, while driving with a girlfriend, Nate was seriously injured in a car wreck.
That was the beginning of the end, when that car flipped and he got staples in his head because he kept drinking.
He checked himself out of the hospital. He had a performance in Vegas. He left to go do that, still with the internal bleeding, still sick. Should have been in the hospital. And then from there, it just pretty much went downhill.
A few months after that, Nate suffered a massive stroke.
He just lost the use of his left side, which was a big deal because he was left-handed. So he had to rely on a little bit more people, a little more to do things for him.
You know, he had to have his double shot of Hennessy and his weed. And I honestly believe that that eventually went to his mind, and all of a sudden, stroke.
Me and my wife went to go visit him, and my wife had said something to him. She was like, I thought you said you broke up with her. And he was like, nah, I can't break up with her yet. I still love her. And I didn't know what the hell they was talking about. Then I looked down, and there was a bottle of Hennessy right by his leg. And I'm like, okay.
Nate gradually got back on his feet, then surprised everyone by forming a gospel choir called In Nate Praise.
When he was like, yeah, man, I want to start a choir. And I was just like, really? He's like, yeah, I want to start a choir. He was like, go on Craigslist and post auditions for this coming weekend. I said, okay. So the next morning I got up, I got on Craigslist, I post auditions for a hip hop crooner starting a choir, and we started getting the phone calls.
I auditioned and I got in the group. Then it turned into him kind of really mentoring me and supporting me and uplifting me.
In Nate Praise, then he was giving something for my mother and father to listen to. They would listen to that. That's what was bringing him back over here on the side of where we was raised at.
He had me and some of the my family members come over and to the studio where he had them and help them out with some songs that he wanted to sing.
He loved his mother like you wouldn't believe and felt that he needed to make a commitment in the art form that she could listen to, that she could appreciate. And that was his way of saying, Mom, I'm your boy, and that part of me still exists, and I want to express it in my art.
Nate Dogg was living a kind of triple life, struggling to recover from a stroke, leading a gospel choir, and still living the high life of a rap star.
We just kind of like scolded him, like, do right, do right, do this, do that. You got high blood pressure, take your medicine. We would be on him all the time.
A lot of people told him, Nate, maybe you shouldn't be drinking. You know, he said, no, I'm gonna do this. Let me do me. You know, don't worry about me.
I knew what he was doing, and I always prayed for him because I know he was in a position that he needed God to protect him.
In another startling move, Nate Dogg abruptly married his then-girlfriend, LaToya Calvin, in the summer of 2008. But a few weeks later, she filed for divorce.
He had high blood pressure, and that had to be maintained, and he was taking medication for that. But I think the stress factor and the intensity of both the lifestyle and just all the things he was dealing with, it eventually, you know, took its toll.
A few months after that, Nate Dogg suffered a second massive stroke, one which would physically incapacitate him for the rest of his life.
He was paralyzed from the neck down. Couldn't walk or talk. Couldn't do anything. And that was hard to take for 2.5 years.
He had to literally give up everything that he did. He couldn't take care of himself.
He had to get a tracheotomy, so that impacted his ability to speak. I give credit to his mother and working with her sister to initiate a method where we could communicate beyond just the eye movement.
He would look at a group of letters and
crooner singing some hardcore street stuff. That was kind of funny at first, but then he put it down.
It wasn't that him singing, you know, gangster was new. It's a lot of guys that the son gangster, you know, but it's the way he did it, and however he feeling at that point, he gonna talk about it, and he gonna sing it in a way to where you listen like, damn.
But for all his impact on G-Funk, friends say that Nate Dogg was never really a G.
In Long Beach, I was a part of a gang, but Nate wasn't a part of a gang. Nate chose to sing and do his thing with us.
Nate was more like a hustler with it. You know, if it was like a little dirt had to be done in situations, mainly about money. But far as running out there, shooting another brother and acting silly, ain't none of that going on.
Not that Nate was immune from trouble. By 1994, he'd been arrested several times, including criminal charges for robbing a check cashing company and a Taco Bell.
Long Beach, California is just street life, period, all day, every day. And so we all got caught up in you know, that way of life.
Okay, tough guys, bend over. Now, call.
Nate beat the raps, then used them as inspiration for his first solo single, a song he titled One More Day. Now
kind of like describing, you know, the life of a Long Beach guy trying to make it out. And then he was kind of describing himself. Usually, I'm in the house, but today I snuck off. And when I walk down the Long Beach streets, what a lesson they taught.
And he was like, thank you, Lord, for one more day, because tomorrow ain't promised. I can go to jail. One more day. One more day. That's like a penitentiary thing. Some of my people that I know, that was one of their favorite songs by Nate. And you can hear the church in that too.
His
thing was to sing and to connect that way. But he still was gangster. So his whole mentality and his whole delivery was based off that.
That mentality came in handy at Death Row Records, where Nate often recorded with other artists, notably Tupac Shakur, and where he'd been signed to a song publishing deal by Suge Knight, for better or worse.
He never went there without his pistol. He said, when I go there, I handle my business, and that's it.
I seen Nate putting on a bulletproof vest, and I'm like, hold on, player, what are we going to the studio? Or finna go to Iraq, what's up? What kind of studio is this where we gotta put bulletproof vests on and walk in? I mean, how can we even work around this type of environment?
I mean, at a certain point, we all felt uncomfortable. And that's just the truth of it all. We come from the streets and we come from the hood. It's better to be caught with than without.
Nate had his guns with him every time. He just used to say, man, I feel fear of my life every time I walk into this building. And Suge would just say, oh, they ain't gonna touch you. Don't worry about it. But it was almost like to keep the foot on the neck.
Despite all that, through the mid-90s, Nate recorded tracks at Death Row for his first solo album there, or so it seemed.
As the years went on without the release of his stuff, then he started getting, you know, angry and bothered and hurt.
We had finished the record, everything was ready to roll, and Suge acted like he was gonna put the record out, but he still had him on, you know, on the shelf. And then that's like when the relationship started to fall apart.
Finally, in 1998, 6 years after he began recording, Nate released his debut album on Breakaway Records, fueled by a surprisingly emotional ballad he sang with Snoop Dogg called Never Leave Me Alone.
Nate Dogg was able to tap into an emotion that, you know, we as gangsters at the time, we wasn't able to. But it was the emotion of Nate Dogg being able to open his heart up and show me how to open my heart up, which is Never Leave Me Alone. We had never really had a record where we expressed our vulnerability as far as not wanting to be alone.
My brother did not like to be alone. That's why I used to always say I couldn't be in a cage. I couldn't be in jail.
I've traveled so many places.
I traveled so many places, I seen so many faces. That line right there just had me feeling good. It kind of, that song was like sad, but banging at the same time.
Never Leave Me Alone became Nate Dogg's first charting single as a solo artist. Unsung, the story of Nate Dogg. The man who became Nate Dogg grew up in Clarksdale, Mississippi as Nathaniel Hale Jr., the second of three children, and the son of a Baptist minister.
My dad will hate me because he loves Mississippi, but they were slow. They were still sitting on the porch swatting mosquitoes in a very small town, one of everything.
We got our own eggs out the chicken coop. Ate them. My father shot pigs in the head, bop, hang them up, cut them, and we got our meat. That's how we live.
His dad was a pastor. And his mom was like in charge of the singing and stuff in the church.
I started a kids' choir at the church. So that's what we've done. Our family is just singing. That's what we do.
My mom made a little group. It was a little trio, Pam, Buddy, and Sam. Buddy, also known as Nate.
Can you imagine being in a home with a pastor? There was no music being listened to unless it was gospel music.
But when Nate was 14, his parents divorced and he moved to Long Beach and a very different musical scene.
I went to Poly High School in 1986 and we had a class together, you know, freestyling and rapping and singing, and we're supposed to be learning, but at the same time, we was learning each other and learning, you know, how to have style.
Snoop was doing his rap thing and Nate was walking around singing and stuff. So they would have little battles at lunchtime, you know, and it just got popular.
At age 17, Nate left high school to join the Marines He served 3 years as a munitions specialist, but was discharged under murky circumstances.
He came home unauthorized a couple of times, and my grandfather had to drive him back to Camp Pendleton. But he eventually got out because he said he didn't want to be there anymore. He didn't like it. He didn't like being told what to do.
He did say it taught him a lot. He told us that they teach you to not have no fear of nothing.
Returning to the hard streets of Long Beach in the late 80s, Nate Dogg reunited with Snoop Dogg and with their homie, Warren G.
At that time, me and Snoop was just, we was all over the place, going to clubs and stuff like that. And then when we connected with Nate, we was like, well, we want you to be with us. You know, you could be the person to do the singing in the group.
Snoop, Warren, and Nate formed a group called 213 after the local area code and worked on demos in the back of a store called VIP Records.
I mean, this is where it all started, without a doubt and stuff. And, you know, the fact that, you know, I was able to do something in the neighborhood to pull these cats up off the street and stuff and give them a safe place to practice on their skills. I was really excited about the demo tape that we did.
You know, you got to get your music to the right person. Get it to the right person. If they like it, it's on after that. It just happened to be Warren knew Dre.
Dre was Dr. Dre of N.W.A., Warren G.'s stepbrother, and already a top-of-the-line producer at Death Row Records.
Warren G used to keep the tape on him. He ended up going to a bachelor party that Dr. Dre had threw for one of his friends. And Warren G, you know, took it amongst himself to slide our cassette in.
I was like, this is me, Nate, and Snoop. You know, my group I've been telling you about.
Well, he ended up having me and Nate Dogg and Warren G come to the studio. He seen something in us to where it was like, I could really work y'all. Like, I could really bring out the best in y'all.
But for all that, only Snoop was signed as an artist to Death Row, effectively ending 213 as a group.
We were 213 when we were presented to Dr. Dre. It wasn't Snoop Doggy Dogg, it was 213. It made me feel real bad that I got a contract and I'm signing, my homeboys don't.
Dre did include Nate on a track on his classic LP, The Chronic. But Nate's real breakthrough came in 1994 when he co-starred with Warren G on Warren's first single, Regulate, about a robbery gone wrong.
It was a clear black night, a clear white moon. Warren G was on the streets trying to consume some skirts for the E so I could get some phones, rolling in my ride, chilling all alone.
Just hit the east side of the LBC on a mission trying to find Mr. Warren G. Seen a car full of girls, ain't no need to tweak. All of you search, know what's up with 213.
So I told Nate, let's try to do something different. So I said, well, I started off with the first four bars, and then I want you to come in with four bars after me.
Since these girls peeping me, I'm on glide and swerve. These looking so hard, they straight hit the curve. Want to bigger, better things than some horny tricks. I see my homie and some suckers all in his mix.
It was a story. It was like the singing version of Run DMC with him and Warren G. And it was catchy as hell.
They got my homie hemmed up and they all around. Can't none of them see him if they going straight down for pound. They want to come up real quick before they start to clown. I best pull out my...
That hadn't really been heard before, where you had a rapper and a vocalist compliment each other, really making a song that really felt like they wrote it together.
Featured in the film Above the Rim, Regulate shot into the top 10 singles charts for pop, R&B, and hip-hop.
It was, you know, unique at the time, and that was the introduction for Nate to the world.
To have a smooth,